אוקיי, בעוד בערך שבועיים וחצי יהיה ל"ג בעומר. אנחנו תוך כדי ספירת העומר. שכחתי שההרצאה צריכה להיות באנגלית. אוקיי.
ועוד בשביל זה אני פה.
Right. אוקיי. So in another 2.5 weeks we will we'll have Lag Ba'Omer, and Lag Ba'Omer is a date that connected very much with the famous Tana Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai was one of the great Tanaim. He mentioned his name mentioned many times in the Mishnah, but it was a story that you probably know about. I want to repeat it and just make sure that everybody know the exact details about it. How Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai became so famous in the Kabbalah, or connected his name connected to the secret level of the Torah. So actually it happened in a very sad way. Let me give you some review of the history. First of all, the time from where we are holding now. We are now in the year 5774 in the Jewish calendar. The time where Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai was alive and active in Eretz Israel at the old time is a distance of 1786 years this year. 1786. 1786 years since Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai passed away in Lag Ba'Omer. Lag Ba'Omer is his yahrzeit, is the time that he passed away. So, about approximately 120 years before, it was the destruction of the second temple. The second Beit HaMikdash was destroyed by the Romans at the time. At the time, we have to know if we want to really understand Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai and the entire contribution to the Kabbalah that connected to his name, we have to know his sources and his teachers. So, in brief, it's a whole review that we should do, but I will mention a few of the famous ones that maybe some of you know about. It was a famous Tana at the time of the Mishnah. His name, Rabban Yochanan ben Zakkai. Rabban Yochanan ben Zakkai lived at the time of the destruction of the second Beit HaMikdash. He was in Yerushalayim when the Romans was around, and he managed to trick the Romans and trick the Jews that were there and didn't let him go. He pretend that he is dead, and his disciples took him out of the city of Yerushalayim in order to bury him outside, because the Jews inside, the extremers, didn't let anybody to go out or in. So he pretend that he is dead, and they buried him, or they have to take him to bury him outside. When he came outside, he met the Roman general there, and he asked him, he informed him that he's going to be the next Caesar in Rome, before he knew it. And a few minutes after he said it to him, the messenger came from Rome and told him, listen, you are going to be the next Caesar. So he was so impressed. And he asked him, what do you want me to do for you? He asked him to give him the Shoshelet of Rabban Gamliel, which is the Sanhedrin that was in Yerushalayim, and let the Sanhedrin, which is the Supreme Court of the Jews, to operate again, not in Yerushalayim, but in Yavne. And then the Supreme Court moved from Yerushalayim to Yavne, and in Yavne was a big Bet Midrash, the Supreme Court stayed there. And many things that we learn in the Mishnah are the things that happened in the next 150 years in Yavne and in other places. So the famous names are Rabban Yochanan ben Zakkai. Rabban Yochanan ben Zakkai has few disciples. One of the famous ones is Rabbi Eliezer, Rabbi Eliezer ben Horkanos. He was his disciple of Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai. The disciple of Rabbi Eliezer Agador, Rabbi Eliezer ben Horkanos, was the famous Rabbi Akiva. And the disciple of Rabbi Akiva was Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. So we're talking about approximately 100 years after the destruction of the Second Temple, when Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai was active and he was a member of the Sanhedrin. Now, the Romans did many terrible things in this period of time to the Jews. First and foremost, they destroyed the temple. They burned Jerusalem. Right after that, 52 years after Jerusalem falls, was the falling of the biggest city that left after, which is Beitar, if you heard the name. It was a big city south to Jerusalem, and over there a few years before was the famous rebel of Bar Kokhba. Bar Kokhba was the leader of the Jews at the time, and he made a lot of troubles to the Romans. He actually has a kingdom inside Israel, in this city, Beitar, inside Eretz Israel, in the city of Beitar. Rabbi Akiva was there for him, and he was his spiritual supportive of Bar Kokhba. But after 2.5-3 years, Bar Kokhba was killed, and Beitar fell down, and it happened 52 years exactly after Jerusalem in the same day, in Tisha B'Av. After they did those two things, destruction of Jerusalem and Beit HaMikdash and Beitar, and many, many Jews got killed at the time, the Romans, killed the 10 spiritual leaders of the Jews in a very cruel way. One of them, the famous one, was Rabbi Akiva. Rabbi Akiva was murdered by the Romans when he was 120 years. And his death was horrible. They didn't kill him. The words of the Gemara, they sarku et besaro b'masrekot shel barzel. They took his...
Torture.
Yeah, they tortured him in a way that they cut his skin, his skin and his flesh on his body. And he was okay. So Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai was his disciple, and Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai knew the history. And of course, it's extra to say that he felt very, very hard against the Romans, like everybody else at the time, right? So here's the story. Because of this, we got the present called The Secrets of the Kabbalah. What was the story? I'll quote to you the story, how it's mentioned in the Gemara, but right before this, we know that those days between Pesach and Shavuot are the days we call Sfirat HaOmer. Now, Sfirat HaOmer has three meanings. Two mentioned in the Torah. The first one is, the Torah says, the second day after Yom Tov Rishon Shel Pesach, you have to bring a Korban, Korban Mincha, that's called Korban HaOmer. Right after that, you have to count 49 days, and then at the 15th day, you have to bring another Korban called Shtei HaLechem, which is was sacrificed in Shavuot. So this is the original purpose of the Sfira, of the counting, right? From Korban HaOmer to Korban Shtei HaLechem, and because of that, we're calling it Sfirat HaOmer, the counting of the Omer. Another reason, that mentioned also in the Torah, to be ready, to count the days from the time that we were free from being slaves to Paro, to the time that we become the nation of God, which was in Shavuos when we got the Torah, right? Many people today knows the Sfira, Sfirat HaOmer, as a mourning day, a mourning period of time, right? We are not hearing music, we are not getting married, we are not shaving or taking haircuts. It's a mourning period. But here's the story. This thing is not part of the Sfira. The Sfira days, all those Sfira 50 days, should be a happy period of time. It was not in the original, it was not a mourning time. But because of the very sad events that happened at the time, before Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai was a later student, disciple of Rabbi Akiva. The Gemara in Masechet Yevamot brings this following story. Rabbi Akiva says, Rabbi Akiva, the famous teacher Rabbi Akiva, taught the following. He says the following. Lamad Torah beyalduto, yilmad Torah bezaknuto. If somebody were lucky enough to learn Torah when he was young, when he getting old, he should continue to learn. Because you could always learn more. Now he says the following. Hayu lo talmidim beyalduto. If he was lucky not just to learn Torah when he was young, but to teach Torah, yihyu lo talmidim bezaknuto. And Rabbi Akiva recommend here, actually said it clearly. If you are a good teacher, never retired. Continue to teach. If you had a lot of students when you were young, when you were old, continue. Teach more people. Teach more students. And Rabbi Akiva said that, among the other things, because a personal experience that he has. And here's the Gemara bring the following. 12,000 zugot talmidim ayu lo l'Rabbi Akiva. Rabbi Akiva was a big, great teacher. And he has many, many students. Imagine 24,000 students for one teacher. There were 12 chavruta, meaning two people that learn with each other. 12,000. Together are 24,000. Kulam, says the Gemara, metu beperek echad. And all of them got passed away. They didn't get killed. They passed away in a plague that killed so many, all of them, 24,000, beperek echad, in very short period of time. And it was between Pesach to Shavuot. There is a reason over here, I don't have time now to go to it. וכולם מתו בפרק אחד מפני שלא נהגו כבוד זה לזה. Because they didn't appreciate each other. So we have to understand this. This is a big thing. This כבוד, כבוד התורה, they didn't appreciate what happened. But anyway, they all passed away in a very short time. And this huge, amazing yeshiva, I don't think that ever in the history we have one teacher that has so many students. And all of them got killed. So nothing left from all the Torah that he taught them. And the Gemara says, V'haya ha'olam shamim. And the world, the Jewish world, was deserted completely. The Torah could not continue because all of the students died. Ad sheba Rabbi Akiva, etzel rabotayim shebadarom, Rabbi Akiva didn't give up. He started from the beginning. And that's what he mentioned before. If you taught students when you were young, continue when you are old. And he said because of his personal experience. So one of the famous students that he had when he was old was, here's the name, Ad Sheba Rabbi Akiva Etzel Rabotenu Shebadarom Ushna Aleim. And who was his famous students in the second version, right? Rabbi Meir, the famous Rabbi Meir that mentioned in the Mishnah always, V'Rabbi Yehuda, ורבי יוסי, ורבי שמעון, which is רבי שמעון בר יוחאי, ורבי אלעזר בן שמוע. והם הם העמידו תורה באותה שעה. And from those five, the entire Torah continue to the next generation until we got it today. So the Gemara says that העולם היה שמם. The Jewish world was deserted. It almost was as dangerous that if Rabbi Akiva will not continue or to teach later on, the Torah was gone. We will not have the Torah anymore. And the Gemara says, "Vekulam metu באותו פרק זמן, in the same time, in this period of time, that we, between Pesach to Shavuot, and later on it's mentioned that it actually was not all this 49 days, but only 33 of them, until Lag BaOmer. Therefore, in Lag BaOmer, we're stopping the morning in the in this time of the Sfirat HaOmer, and we have a very unique, special day. Aside from that, as we said, after it happened, Rabbi Akiva went to teach, and his new students, one of them was Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. Years later, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, he was great Tana, and he wrote the Secret of the Torah. His last day of life, of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, was Lag BaOmer. And those two events connected together. The event that happened before, that this plague was years before, until Lag BaOmer, and Lag BaOmer, they stopped dying. And then later on, when Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai passed away in the same day. Now, there is something very special about this day, Lag BaOmer. We'll see how much we could cover from this, but let's go on and try to understand what Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai did. So here's the story. As I mentioned before, Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, years ago, right after the destruction of the temple, asked Aspasianus, which was the Roman commander at the time, and he told him that you're going to be the next Caesar in Rome. He asked him to let him continue this institution called the Sanhedrin, the Supreme Court. But it has to move from Yerushalayim because anyway they're going to destroy Yerushalayim. So it's moved to Yavne. Yavne, do you know, I mean, some the Israelis among you know where is Yavne? Yavne is near Rehovot. You know where's Rehovot in Israel? So south, over there Yavne. Over there become the center, the spiritual center of the Jews at the time. So the Sanhedrin was there for a few generations, and the Gemara in Masechet Shabbat Bedaf Lamed Gimel, Lag BaOmer, Daf Lamed Gimel, Masechet Shabbat, the Gemara brings the following story. כשנכנסו רבותינו לכרם דיבנה, when our rabbis were gathering together in Yavne, היה שם רבי יהודה, try to remember the names, רבי יהודה ורבי אלעזר ברבי יוסי ורבי שמעון. I'll give you an overview to understand what's going on over here. The Sanhedrin are the Supreme Court. We have to know, many people do not know this, that in the Sanhedrin, the judges in the Sanhedrin are not allowed from Din Torah, from the Torah, they are not allowed to get paid for teaching and judging people. They are not allowed. So how they manage to live? Each one of them has a business. Shammai, lemashal, for example, Shammai, the famous Shammai, Shammai veHillel, he has a business. You know what was his business? He was a constructor. Yeah, a favorite business of Israelis who come to America, right? Constructor. So he was a constructor. Rabbi Yochanan was Rabbi Yochanan HaSandlar. He was a shoemaker. And all of them, they were great people. They were the leaders, the spiritual leader, but they never get paid for teaching Torah.
Who appointed them?
There is something called smicha. Smicha is to appoint. And only one who is appointed could appoint others when they are ready for this. So the first smicha in the Torah mentioned at the end of the Sefer Bamidbar, when Moshe Rabbeinu was told, informed that he is not going to cross the Jordan River, Hashem told him, "Kach lecha et Yehoshua binun, ish asher ruach bo, v'samachta et yadcha alav." Appoint him. So here's the first time that was a smicha. He made him to be the next leader. So Moshe Rabbeinu himself actually established the first Supreme Court in the desert. That's called, at the time in the Torah, it's called Ziknei Israel, Shiv'im Mizikne Israel. The number of the members of the Supreme Court and the Sanhedrin are 70. Actually 71, 70 without the president. The president was at the time Moshe Rabbeinu, right? So since then, in order to be member of the Sanhedrin, you have to have a member of the Sanhedrin to appoint the others. The next one, okay?
It was based on their skills?
Yes, absolutely. Skills, not just smartness, or, you know, they do not have just to have tests that they know things. They have to not just know, but live up to what they know. And the teacher is the one to estimate if this disciple ready for it or not. Okay? So anyways, the Gemara bring over here, now the Supreme Court, all the 71, not always was in the full form there, but it was always in the place at least three that could judge or teach, right? So the Gemara bring a story over here that at the time it was Rabbi Yehuda, Rabbi Elazar, Rabbi Yossi, and Rabbi Shimon. So some people came and asked them question in the law, and they answer. But the Gemara says that when they were asked, all three of them, Rabbi Yehuda, Rabbi Elazar, and Rabbi Shimon, who answered? You know, they discuss it, but somebody was, one of the three, has to present the answer. So what the Gemara says, Na'ana Rabbi Yehuda b'Rabbi Elai, Rosh medabrim b'chol makom ve'amar. He was the one to answer. From all the three, Rabbi Yehuda, and the Gemara bring him a title. What is the title? Rosh HaMedabrim Bechol Makom. He is the one that always is the speaker. So the Gemara asks, it's a funny title. Who gave him this title and why? Why Rabbi Yehuda, more than the others, than Rabbi Eliezer or Rabbi Shimon, he is the Rosh HaMedabrim Bechol Makom. And here, the Gemara brings the amazing story. Before this event, it was another event. Again, in the Sanhedrin, it was not teaching Torah, but the rabbis came to the Sanhedrin in order to, you know, start the day. But before, they just talked a regular day-to-day conversation. So the first student who came, every time, you know, was the student who were sitting there. The first student who came there, his name was Rabbi Yehuda ben Gerim. That was his name, Yehuda ben Gerim. So his parents or the parents of his parents become converted to Judaism, but he was a good Jew who came to learn Torah. So he caught the rabbis coming to the room, and before they start to teach Torah, he was listening to what they sang, and they spoke about politics. A regular, mundane conversation about politics. Could you imagine what they could speak about at the time? About the empire, the Roman Empire, right? They were like America of today. Everybody speaks about them. What they're doing, what their policy. So the rule is that Sichat Chulin Shel Talmidei Chachamim Tzricha Limud. If you have Talmidei Chachamim, great people, they're not just talking stam, like politics, like the journalist or everything is very calculated. They think about what they're saying. So Yehuda ben Gerim, he was a lucky one to hear what the rabbi is saying, not in Torah, right? So he was listening and he heard the following. Look at the story. Patach Rabbi Yehuda. So who were there? Rabbi Yehuda, Rabbi Yossi, and Rabbi Shimon. Those are the rabbis. And Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai was one of them. Rabbi Yehuda, Rabbi Yossi, and Rabbi Shimon. So Rabbi Yehuda started, and he says about the Romans. You know, we have a lot against the Romans. They destroyed Beit HaMikdash. They burned Yerushalayim. They killed so many Jews in Beitar, right? They are very, very terrible to us. But, says Rabbi Yehuda, if we want to be objective, we could look objectively and see that they did also good things. They're not that bad. I mean, of course, what they did is terrible, but there is also good things that they do. What? So he said the following, Kama na'im ma'asehem shel uma zo. Tiknu shvakim, tiknu gsharim, tiknu merchatzaot. They were the first ones who made markets, a real market Until the time of the Romans, you know, everybody wants tomatoes, was going to his friend and say, you have tomatoes in your, I have cucumbers, so let's trade. So in order to get tomatoes, you have to get to this one. Then you have to get oranges, you have to go to get this one. They were the first one who made markets that people come with their merchandise in the same in a center place and everybody will come. So this is very convenient. And he said, Rabbi Yehuda says, you know what? You could say whatever about the Romans, but something good they did. They made markets. The other thing, they made bridges. Tiknu gsharim. It also was very hard before. But now you have bridges over the rivers, and they did it. The other thing, tiknu merchatzaot. You just could think, today everybody has a shower in their house. But that was not the case in the old time. And the old time was house. If you want to take a shower, you go to the river in the middle of the night, right? So they made merchatzaot, not a private shower in every house, but they made batei merchatz, houses that people could come there. So that was a chidush. It's a new thing at the time, and they did it. So they contribute a lot to our life. If you want to really be objective, don't look like about the bad things that they did. They did also good things. That's what Rabbi Yehuda has to say. Rabbi Yehuda is Rabbi Yehuda b'Rabbi Eli. His two friends, Rabbi Yossi and Rabbi Shimon, heard the good things that he has to say about the Romans and they could not agree with him. How could you say that those terrible people who murdered so many Jews, you give them credit for things that they did? But Rabbi Yossi didn't say anything. He was keeping quiet in a way that, you know what, I'm not supporting you, but I'm not saying anything against what you say. Just, it's called in Hebrew, shtika ro'emet. He was quiet, but it was very strong quiet. I do not agree with you, but he didn't say it in words. But Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai could not hold himself. And he said, they didn't do anything good. They all bad. Everything that they did, even the thing that you mentioned, it was all their interest. It's not for us. They are completely evil. And he mentioned all the things and said, you see, they did it for the interest. I'll mention only one of the things. Why I mention it? Because every time that I'm going on the Verrazano Bridge or any other bridge over here, I remember this Gemara in Masechet Shabbat Daf Lamed Gimel. He said, they made bridges. Do you think they made bridges for us? They made bridges only to take taxes from them. You have to pay toll, right? For that they did it. So don't give them any credit. Okay, that was the conversation. And Rabbi Yehuda ben Gerim was listening to this. And when the other students came, he told them, listen, let me tell you, I was lucky to hear a political statement from our rabbis. And Rabbi Yehuda says that, Rabbi Yossi kept quiet, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai was really against, he was really extreme. From, you know, people talking, and it goes, and the Gemara says that the words of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai got to the ears of the Romans. And the Romans were very, very, very sensitive of any criticism. They were very cruel. After they killed Rabbi Akiva, they killed the entire Jewish intellectual leaders that hold the Jewish identity different than the Romans. They have, you know, the secret service, the intelligence was always looking for information of people that could be rebels. So they heard what Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai says, and they made this decision. Yehuda Sheila, Rabbi Yehuda, that speaks good about us, about the Romans. From now on, any time that will be any question of any Jews in the Jewish law, only Rabbi Yehuda allowed to answer. Therefore, he got this title, Rosh HaMedabrim Bechol Makom. Who gave him this title? The Romans, because he says he's looking at us as good. So he will be the one to answer. Right? So because of this, the Gemara brings the entire story. Yossi, Rabbi Yossi, that didn't say anything, he didn't say against us anything, but he didn't agree with Rabbi Yehuda, he will go to exile. So they exiled him from Yavne to Tzipori. From Tzipori is a place, is a city in the north, near Tveria. So he will not be living over here in where the Supreme Court is in Yavne. He will go to exile. Shimon, which is Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, Shegina, that speaks against us, Yehareg. They made a decree on him, a death penalty. So he become a person that the Romans are after him and they want to kill him. After they killed his rabbi, Rabbi Akiva. So Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai knew or was aware of the situation, and he decided to go underground. So the Gemara says that in the beginning, he just went underground over there. He was not hiding, but instead of coming to the Supreme Court where the Roman could find him, he went to any little synagogue, little shul, and learned Chavrusa like a simple person with his son, Rabbi Elazar. His wife was giving him every day food in order for him to survive. But the Romans were very, very hard, and they start looking and more and become dangerous. One day, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai felt they're going to come and get me. So one day, he came to Rabbi Elazar's son and says, it's too dangerous to stay here. We have to disappear. And nobody in the world should know where we are, not even your mother. And they disappeared. They disappeared, they went to the north, and they went to a cave, not a place where other people are, and they hide in this cave. The Gemara says, Itrachish Nisa, because now nobody knows where they are, and until now his wife was bringing in food. What are they going to do now? So it was a miracle, and on the opening of this cave, it was a... I don't know the name of the tree. Etz shel charuvim, carob? Carob tree. It was growing over there, and they ate the fruit of the carobs. And Mayan shel mayim, it was also a stream. How do you say Mayan? A stream, but there is a way. There is a word in English.
Brook.
A what?
A brook?
Yeah, something like brook. A stream of water. And from this, they were eating and drinking. They stayed in this cave for 12 years. Nobody knew where they are. They just disappeared. Nobody knew. And for those 12 years, they learned Torah 24/7. They eat when they have to eat. They daven, they pray when they have the time of the pray. But they learned Torah with no destruction. Nobody bothered them. They got to the level that they learned the entire Torah, and Hashem revealed to them the secrets of the Torah. And through this, we got the secrets of the Torah, which is the Kabbalah. Now, after 12 years, constant 12 years, the Gemara says that Eliyahu Hanavi came and stood on the opening of this cave, and he announced, the Caesar, or the leader, the Roman leader that made this decree that Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai has to be put to death, this Caesar or this leader died. So the rule was, when the leader died, all the decree that he made in his life are not relevant anymore. So Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai could come out. So Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai and Rabbi Eliezer come out, and Rabbi Elazar, his son, came out. But after they got those levels of being so spiritual, they were not fitting anymore to this world. The Gemara says the following. They came out of this cage, the cave, and they saw people working in the fields. You know, working in order to make money. So Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai told his son, are those people okay? They're crazy. Manichim chayei olam ve'oskim b'chayei sha'a? What are you doing? They live in the physical dimension. They do not. They left the spiritual dimension. So the Gemara says that anywhere that they were looking, it was a fire that was burning it out. Yatzab et kol mishamayim. Hashem speak to them and said, "What are you doing? Are you going to destroy my world? Go back to your cave." And they came back. I mean, they had to return to the cave. And they stayed there another 12 months. Altogether 13 years. After 13 years, they learned the lesson and they came out. And basically, there are more details, but basically that was a period of time that Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, 13 years, it's not by chance those numbers. I just will give you a hint. The gematria, the summary of the amount of the word 13, of the number 13, is echad. And aleph, chet, dalet. Aleph is 1, chet is 8, dalet is 4, together is 13, right? The Jewish tribes are 12, and actually is 13, because Yosef is divided to Menashe and Ephraim. So, that what we said, Ata echad v'shimcha echad umika amcha Yisrael goy echad. Echad is 13, right? But it's 12 that become 13. Over here also, it was 12 years, and then another year, together is echad. What is the meaning of echad? There is a Zohar, a famous Zohar. The Zohar says that Yisrael ve'oraita ve'kutcha berichu chadhu. The Jewish nation and the Torah and the Kadosh Baruch Hu is one, is unified. How? Hashem is one. Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. And when we do His Torah, His will, His direction, His instruction, we become one with His will. Therefore, we are one. And one is 13. As you know, 13 is a very scary number for non-Jews. Right? They scare from this number, 13. It's a bad luck, right? That's what they believe, right? For us, we have to know, is one of the good ones. Just few things that connected to 1, to 13. 13 is the bar mitzvah. When a kid become unified with the nation, he become part of the nation, right? 13 are the 13 rules that connect Torah Shebichtav and Torah Shebe'al Peh. 13 midot she'atorah nidreshet b'hem, that you connect. So you see the common denominator is connection, to take things that are separated or not and unify them, meaning one, right? And there is another thing. 13 midot she'rachamim. After Chet Ha'Egel, it was a decree on the Jewish people, Chas v'Shalom, Heref mimeni v'ashmidem. Then Moshe Rabbeinu prayed, and Hashem taught him or revealed to him the secret of 13 midot shel rachamim, that after the separation to be unified again is to do tshuva and do 13 midot shel rachamim and become one with Hashem. So 13 is something very big for us, and exactly because of this reason, the non-Jews are scared from this. Why? Why? Because anti-Semitism, in the essence of it, is jealousy of the nations that we saying that we are the only one, and they know about this. We are the only one that was lucky to get covenant with God. We are the chosen people. We are the only nation in the world that as a nation, God talked to us and gave us His instructions, the Torah. They know about it. In a way, they should appreciate us for this. But there is something called jealousy. You know, good student in the class, he is the favorite of his teachers, right? But all the other students hate him. Why? Because if he could be like this, everybody should be like that. So people do not want to be. Why they hate us? Because we brought to the world the moral. And the moral is to tell you, listen, don't do whatever you want or your impulse tells you, you have to do this and this and this. In a way, they should appreciate it. But it's hard, right? It's hard to be this. Therefore, this is the essence of the hatred. So, because we are one with Hashem, which is 13, Echad is the number 13, So number 13 is a very significant number. For us, it's a very good number. For them, it's a very scary number, or they do not like it. Anyway, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai also got his level through this number, 12 and 13. And he got one with the Torah, which is the will of God, with the essence of the Torah. Okay? Now, this is the basic story about what happened to Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, and he became, before that, he was a great Tana. Before that, he was one of the famous Tanaim in the Mishnah. But after that, he went to levels that even the people, the Gemara continues and says that his father-in-law, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, the name of his father-in-law, was also one of the Tanaim in the Mishnah. His name was Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair. Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair was a great Tana also. The Gemara says that when Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai came out of the cave after the 13 years, nobody knew. He disappeared 13 years ago and nobody knew what happened to him. Not even his wife, right? So when he came out and it got public, and people knew, oh, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai returned. One of the people who came to greet him was his father-in-law. And of course, he chose him to be his father-in-law. He chose him to be his son-in-law because he was a great student. He was a great Talmid Chacham, right? So the Gemara says that when Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair met him after, he saw that he badly needed to have a real shower. Because after 13 years, he was buried in the sand over there. So he took him, and he himself took him to bathe him, and he saw that his entire body was with wounds because he was buried under the sand. So he has a lot of wounds. So while he was bathing him, he was crying. Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair, and the tears are salty, and the tears came in touch with the skin of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, and he was screaming because it was salty, you know, lizrot melech al hapzeim. So says Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair, I'm sorry. Oy li shereiticha bekach. I'm sorry that I'm seeing you in this situation. Because spiritually you got to a very high level, but physically he was really in good, very not too good shape. Amar lo Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai says to him, don't say, oy li shereiticha bekach. Ashrecha shereitani bekach. You should be happy that you saw me in this situation. Why? Shilmale lo reitani bekach, lo matzatani kach. If I didn't sacrifice so much in order to get to this level, I will never reach this level. And the Gemara says, before he went to the cave, again, he was a great scholar, a great Talmid Chacham. But before he went to the cave, every time that Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai asked any question in the Torah, his father-in-law, Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair, was able to give him 12 separate answers, complete answer to his question. So he was much higher than him. He could answer his question in 12 different ways. That each one of them was complete, satisfying answer. After he went out of the cage, every question that Rabbi Pinchas ben Yair was asking, in his level, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai could answer him 24 objective, separate, complete answers. So he was in very, very high level after that. Okay. Now, let me just, because we start very late, just explain a little bit about what Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai learned over there and what are actually the secret of the Torah. As you know, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai wrote a book in Kabbalah called Sefer HaZohar. Sefer HaZohar. I will need some help in the translations over here. How do you say Zohar? Do you know what Zohar in Hebrew is? What Zohar? How do you translate Zohar? Not the book. Zohar.
We say Zohar also.
No. How do you say in English the word Zohar? Zohar is radiation. There is a glow, illumination. This is Zohar. Right, right. Mamila Zohar. Now, we have to know, before the time of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, there is a place in the Tanakh, in the Nevuah, in a very interesting place. You know, the Tanakh are Torah, Nevi'im, Ktuvim. Those are the initial. Taf, Nun, Chaf. Torah, Nevi'im, Ktuvim. One of the very mystery books in the Tanakh, in the Ktuvim, is a book called Daniel. Sefer Daniel. Daniel was a very interesting person. He was not a Navi, but he saw a lot of mysterious things. He was expert in solving or interpret explanation of dreams. And he saw many visions. And the Gemara says that all the secrets of the end of days are in Sefer Daniel. At the end of Sefer Daniel, there is a pasuk that speaks about what's going to happen in the history. And over there, let me quote you the pasuk. The pasuk is in Perek Yud Aleph or Yud Bet, just a second. Perek Yud Bet, which is the last Perek of Daniel. He speaks about the end of days, and he says, the quote from the pasuk, it's Pasuk Gimel Beperek Yud Bet, chapter 12, Pasuk, verse 3 and 4. So the verse says the following. והמשכילים יזהירו כזוהר הרקיע. To translate it, those who are will be משכילים, scholars or smart people at the end of days, יזהירו כזוהר הרקיע. They will glow, they will radiate like the זוהר הרקיע, like the radiation from the sky. ומצדיקי הרבים ככוכבים לעולם ועד. Those people who goes and make other people be aware of Hashem and aware of the Torah, this matzdikei harabim, they will make many people going to the right way and being righteous. They will be radiating light like the stars. Umatzdikei harabim ככוכבים לעולם ועד. Now, mentioned in this pasuk, it's mentioned the word Zohar. Vehamazkilim yazhiru kezohar harakia. Says the Zohar himself in Sefer HaZohar, in Sefer Bamidbar, Parashat Be'alotcha. The Zohar brings this pasuk and says the following: Vehamazkilim yavinu yazhiru inun marei Kabbalah. Those are the people who will learn Kabbalah. The Itmar Be'on that it says on them. And here the Zohar quotes this pasuk, והמזכילים יזהירו כזוהר הרקיע. אילן אינון דקמשתדלין בזוהר דה. Those people who are learning and dealing with this book, Sefer HaZohar, the Ikri Sefer HaZohar. So this is the source of the name of this book. Sefer HaZohar is radiation of the sky. Okay? We still do not really understand. I mean, there is a verse over here, right? Now, the next pasuk over there, let me quote those two psukim together. והמשכילים יזהירו כזוהר הרקיע, ומצדיקי הרבים ככוכבים לעולם ועד. Now the next verse. ואתה דניאל, those words was a nevuah that was given to Daniel. He saw it, right? So Hashem says to Daniel, ואתה דניאל, סתום הדברים וחתום הספר עד עת קץ, ישוטטו רבים ותרבה הדעת. So he told, he got information, and Hashem told him, listen, this information is secret. Stom advarim, cover them, v'chatom ha-sefer, and sign this book, ad et ketz. The things that I'm giving you over here will not be explained until the end of days. Yeshotetu rabim v'tirbe hadat. Many people will try to understand it, and that will increase the knowledge in the world, but they are never going to get it because it's a secret. Those are two verses in the last chapter in Daniel. Again, והמשכילים יזהירו כזוהר הרקיע, and the Zohar, Sefer HaZohar said that this is the origin of the word Zohar because of this. And now we have to understand a little bit why it's called Zohar. Zohar. In Hebrew, Zohar is radiation that comes out of a light. When there is a light, the light, the implication of the light is the Zohar. There is so much to say. I will just say one thing in few sentences. Okay. When Hashem created the world, it all goes back to the beginning of the beginning. When Hashem created the world, let me quote you the first five verses in the Tanakh. Should be very famous, right? Bereshit. Every kid learned this. But be aware of the thing that I will emphasize, okay? Bereshit bara Elokim et ha-shamayim ve-et ha-aretz. Everybody knows this verse, right? Bereshit bara Elokim et ha-shamayim ve-et ha-aretz. Second verse, ve-ha-aretz hayta tohu vavohu, ve-choshech al pnei tehom, ve-ruach Elohim merachefet al pnei ha-mayim. So in the beginning, after Hashem created the world, it was dark, right? Ve-ha-aretz hayta tohu vavohu, ve-choshech. No light. Darkness, v'choshech al pnei tehom, v'ruach elayim v'rachefet al pnei amayim. So what was the first thing that Hashem did after he created the heaven and earth? Shamayim v'aretz. It was dark. So we need some light, right? That was the thing. Next verse. V'yomer Elohim yehi or v'yehi or. Be aware or count the numbers, the number of the times that the word or mentioned. So far, two. Again, Bereshit bara Elokim et ha-shamayim ve-et ha-aretz. Ve-ha-aretz hayta tohu vavohu. Ve-choshech al pnei tehom ve-ruach Elohim merachefet al pnei ha-mayim. So, until Pasuk Bet, until the second verse, we have darkness only. Pasuk Gimel. Vayomer Elokim yehi or vayehi or. Next verse. Vayar Elohim et ha-or, number three, right? Vayar Elohim et ha-or ki tov. ויבדל אלוהים בין האור ובין החושך. How many times? So far, four. The last verse, in this first day of the creation, ויקרא אלוהים לאור יום, ולחושך קרא לילה, ויהי ערב, ויהי בוקר יום אחד. This is the description of what Hashem created in the first day. So what was created in the first day? The light. Oh! How many times mentioned? Five. Okay. Let me assume that you know the continuation of the chapter. Could I assume that? Ma nivra b'yom ha-sheni? What Hashem created in the second day? Ve'ivra Elokim et ha-rakia. Ve'yomer Elokim yehi rakia betoch ha-mayim ve'yehi mavdil ben mayim le-mayim. Nechon? Okay? That's the second day. Ve'yehi erev ve'yehi boker yom sheni. What Hashem created in the third day? Ve'yomer Elokim yikavu ha-mayim mitachat ha-shamayim el makom echad ve'tereya yabasha. All the water will go to one place and the dry land will be revealed. And another thing was created. Tadshe ha'aretz deshe, esev matzmiach zera. That happened in the third day. Vayar Elokim kitov. Twice the mentioned word tov b'yom ha-shlishi, pa'amayim kitov. Vayera v'yiboker yom shlishi. Now we're coming to the fourth day. What happened in the fourth day? Vayomer Elokim, yehi me'orot birkiya ha-shamayim. And the question is, why we need me'orot? V'hi me'orot b'rkei ha-shamayim le'air al ha'aretz. Why we need me'orot in the fourth day? We have light in the first day already. It was dark, and Hashem says, V'yomer Elokim yi'or v'yor. So, what happened in the fourth day? We have light only from day one. Here comes a secret that you probably heard about. It's called in two words, Ha'or Haganuz. You ever heard about it? Ha'or Haganuz? No? Okay. So, Ha'or Haganuz means that the Medrash says, it's very famous. I wonder why you do not know about it, but if you didn't hear about it until now, from now on you could not say this anymore. Because I'm going to tell you. Ha'or Shebara HaKadosh Baruch Hu Bayom HaRishon. The light that Hashem created in the first day was very, very strong. Very powerful. So in the fourth day, Hashem says, it's too strong. And he took this light, v'uganazoto. He put him in a safe. Gnizaz a safe. He put him in a safe. Meaning he didn't just make it disappear. He took it and put it in a hidden place. And that's called Ha'or Haganuz. It's in the safe. So after he took this light and put it in the safe, it became dark again. No light. Then Hashem created Me'orot. What are the Me'orot? The sun and the moon and the stars. How they called? Me'orot. Me'orot. Now if you go, here it's a little bit shame that I don't have the sources in front of your eyes, but you could do homework for this. Open the Tanakh, open Sefer Bereshit, and look yourself at the fourth day of the creation. You'll find out that the word Me'orot mentioned in the fourth day, five times. Me'orot. Hama'or ha-gadol le-memshelet ha-yom, hama'or ha-katon le-memshelet ha-laila. So it's not mentioned or, but or with the letter mem in the beginning. Me'orot, ma'or gadol, five times. Parallel to what happened in the first day. But in the first day, it was or, alev vav reish. In the fourth day, it's me'orot. In Kabbalah sources, it's mentioned the following. The ultimate light that we have is the light of the sun. We do not have any concept of a light stronger or bigger than the light of the sun. For us, it seems the ultimate light. So we have to know that it's not true. This is the light that we could see. I'll explain this. This is the ultimate light that we could grasp. But there is bigger light than this. And this bigger light was the light that Hashem created in the first day of the creation. But because it was too big and too strong, Hashem hid it. And this is what's called Ha'or Haganuz. Now, just a little bit, I will try to finish it within a few minutes because it's very deep concepts. But we have no time. We started really late. So I'll try to put it to 5 minutes or 10 minutes. What is light? What is the definition of light? What is light? Light is ability, be aware of this definition. Ability, with the light, we have the ability to understand the reality. What I mean by this? Let's take the regular light, the light of the sun. In order to realize what's going on around you, as an intelligent creature, right? In order to realize what's around you, to understand who you are, where are you, what the reality is. Hashem gave us five senses. One of them that's very important, and without it you could not realize where you are, is the vision, the ability to look, to see, right? Now, in order to see, you need two things. Good, healthy eyes and light. You need both. If you have the most amazing, healthy eyes, you could see, 20-20. Or 6-6, 6-6, כמו שאומרים בעברית. You could see very good, okay? But will be no light, you will see darkness. You will see darkness, meaning you do not see anything. You need with the eyes the light. The light gives us the ability to realize the reality, the technical reality, the physical reality. You need light. So light is very important in order to actualize our intelligence. If you were in potential, very intelligent, you have very good eyes, but you have no light, you will not see anything, or you will see darkness. So the physical technical light is, as I said, the way for us to realize reality. Now be aware of the following. We have two kinds of eyes. The physical eyes, which is a camera, very, very sophisticated camera, the eyes. And we have the eyes of the brain, which is not physical. It's intellectual eyes, right? And we speak about in the same way, right? When I want to ask somebody, do you understand what I'm saying? I could say, look, look, meaning don't look with your physical eyes, but think about what I'm saying.
Visualize.
Right. When somebody understands something, how do we say it in English? I see. I see. What do you mean you see? I see it, meaning I understand. So when I'm saying to somebody, I'm saying a concept, and people need to think about it in order to get it. This is to look in it in your intellectual eyes, right? Now, the same way that the physical eyes were worth nothing without light, the intellectual eyes, same thing, worth nothing without light, but not physical light. Physical eyes need physical light. Intellectual eyes, in order to really understand things right, need a intellectual or spiritual or non-physical light. This light is the light that Hashem created in the first day of the creation. Now, it was too strong, too powerful. With this light, if it was today, every single thing will be very clear. No questions about anything. You could see and understand everything to the last details. As you know, when we look around the world today, we understand a lot of things. But more of the details that you see or understand, there are questions that have no answers. There are many unsolved questions. We do not know. We do not understand. We do not understand this and this and that. Many things. With the ultimate light that Hashem created in the first day, everything will be understood. Hashem says it's not good for this world. It will be revealed at the end of days. Therefore, He put this light in the safe in order to create this kind of world, that some of the things will be understood and some not. It's not good because, it's mentioned in the Midrash. The Midrash says the following: Ra'a Kadosh Baruch Hu et ha'or shebara b'yom harishon ve'amad u'gnazo la'tzadikim la'atid lavo. Lama? Mikivan she'hu ra'a she'yu resha'im ba'olam she'ishtamshu im ha'or hazeh lo tov. Az hu mana et zeh mehem. So Hashem says, I created a great light. I just translate what I said before in Hebrew. This is a great light. Because this world is the world of free will, I want people to be free willers. Free willers mean that they will see the good side and the bad side. In order to see the bad side, they have to just dim the light. Do not make it clear. Because if it will be everything clear, everything will be clear, will be no free will. Everybody will do what's right. There will be no room for wrong. And then we will not be free will, we will be robots. And Hashem didn't want us to be robots, He wanted us to be free willer. Therefore, He took this light and made it dimmer. Right? At the end of days, this light will be revealed, and then all the negative that people so appreciate when it was dark will just disappear. Right? Okay. Now, Hashem took this light and put it in a safe. Ganazoto. Zenika ha'or ganuz. Now, the last quote over here is from Kabbalah book that was written by Rabbi Tzadok HaKohen Milublin in a book called Pri Tzadik. In Parashat Tetzaveh, the Sefer Shmot, on the pasuk in the Torah that says that we have to build the Mishkan, and in the Mishkan we have to have a menorah, and the pasuk says, "Ve'ikhu elecha shemen zayit zach katit lamaor." You know that in Beit HaMikdash was a menorah, right? And the menorah was lit in by oil, but this oil should be very pure, from an olive, but only the first drop, without any thing that, only the pure oil, right? Says Rabbi Tzadok HaKohen Milublin in the name of the Kabbalah, he says the following. The inyan shemen zayit zach melamed al haor belo psolet. The more the oil is purified, the flame will be clear, right? Haor belo psolet. This light without any, how do you say psolet?
Dirt.
Any dirt or anything that not belong to it, right? This is the light, the ultimate light that Hashem created in the first day of the creation. And therefore, in Beit HaMikdash, which is something, the holy place in the universe, Hashem commanded us to go and take an oil, pure oil, in order to have this pure light. This is the light that Hashem created in the first day of the creation. But Hashem put it in the safe. Says, and I'm telling you the words of Rabbi Tzadok HaKohen, Ve'or HaRishon, the first light that Hashem created in the first day, Gnazo Hashem Yitbarach Batorah. Where is the safe? What do you mean that Hashem take this light and put it in the safe? Where is the safe? The safe is the Torah. And he says that the word light in the first day of the creation mentioned 5 times. Those 5 times of the word light are Chamisha Chumshei Torah. Bereshit Shmot Vayikra B'Midbar U'Dvarim. When Hashem created in the fourth day, He took from the light only little spark from the big light. And therefore, the ultimate light that we have today, which is the light of the sun, called not light, not or, but Me'orot. What's the addition of the mem in the beginning? The mem in the beginning in Hebrew is from the. Right? If I have a box of oranges and I said, take the oranges, meaning take the entire thing. If I'm telling you, take from the oranges, how do I say it in Hebrew? Me'hatapuzim. Take from it. So the light that we have today is just a little bit from the me'orot. This is the meaning of the addition of the mem in the big in me'orot. Now, in this light, without this light, nothing will function. The light of the sun, of the but we have to know that there is bigger light. But this bigger light is in the safe. We have no access to it. Not really. It's in the Torah. And in the Torah, it's hidden in the Torah. When Hashem gave us the Torah, in Chag HaShavuot, that we're going to celebrate, now we're counting Sefirat HaOmer toward Chag HaShavuot, we got the safe. That in this safe, the 5 books, Chamisha Chumshei Torah, there is, this light is there. But it's not revealed. It's in the deeper, behind the thing. And this is the Kabbalah. The Kabbalah is the secrets of the world, the secret of the creation, and they are in the Torah. Therefore, the book that Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai wrote called Sefer HaZohar, because Zohar is radiation of this light that's inside. And if you understand the Zohar, you understand everything that's happening. You understand the secrets of the Creator, the secrets of God. You know everything. And Hashem says to Daniel, hide it, add 8 kits. Only at the end of days, these things will be revealed. That's what Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai got when he learned Torah intense for 13 years, and he became one with the will of God, and he got this information, and he wrote it in the Torah. But he wrote it in the Torah in a way, because Hashem put it in a safe, right? So you're not allowed to publish it, to make it known. It's secret. Therefore, the Torah, the Kabbalah, is the secret, the sod. You know that there are initial pardes, pshat, remez, drash, v'sod. Sod is a secret. It's the secret of the Torah. Now, it's written in the Zohar, but we have to understand that the Zohar is a book that was written only for people who know the codes. If you do not know the, the only way to know the meaning is to learn it from your teacher, that learn it from his teacher, that learn it from his teacher, and the directions that the teacher will give you are not written anywhere. They are going from teacher to student to teacher to student. And in order for the student to understand what the teacher teach him, it's not enough to be intelligent, bright, and smart. Exactly. You have not just to know, but you have to live up to what you know. It's not just intellectual thing. Your personality should match what you know. It's if there is a contradiction between what you know and how you're running your life, you are not ready. You are not understanding right. It's not just a matter of understanding. The Kabbalah is not just hard or very sophisticated or very deep think, intellect-wise. In order to really understand it right, you have to be holy. You have to live up to it, right? And therefore, until today, even that the Zohar is written, it's not going only to the people. People do not really understand it unless they're really ready for it, meaning that are they... their life are holy. You know, today it's very popular to teach Kabbalah, to learn Kabbalah. It's all nonsense. It's not Kabbalah whatsoever. It's not. Kabbalah, to really understand, it's not just concepts. It's the secrets of God. And we have to know, God says, in the Torah, in the Tanakh, Hashem says, who could understand really the secret? There is a pasuk in Tehillim. The pasuk in Tehillim says, it's in Tehillim Perek Kafhei, chapter 25, verse 14. Sod Hashem li'ireav uvrito lehodiam. The secret could be the secrets of God. Hashem says, you know to who I'm going to give it to? Li'ireav. You have to be Yere Hashem. Yere Hashem meaning knowing and living up to the standards that the Torah put, that Hashem gave. Only those people could really understand the secret. The others could read it, think they understand it, but understand it wrong. Hashem knows how to protect his secrets. And the secret is secret until today. And it will be revealed only at the end of days. And that's what we could cover in the contribution of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai to write the basic book in the Kabbalah, which is Sefer HaZohar. There is much more information, but you know, we could not go in more than that because it's really late now.
So how did Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai live his life once he got to that point after he wrote the Zohar?
Yeah.
What kind of lifestyle did he have? Did he live he was very different from society?
Absolutely.
Around him?
I just mentioned before what the Gemara says. When he came out of the cave after 12 years, he could not understand how people live. Why do you deal and give so much time from your time that you have here to the what he called chaye sha'a, for the physical temporary life? Ozvim chaye olam ve'oskim b'chaye sha'a. Chaye olam meaning the existing forever for the temporary. The temporary is the physical. So most of the people in the world, until today, even great people, right? They deal a lot with physical. Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai was not like this.
How old was he when he passed away?
I don't know. I don't think it's mentioned anywhere what was his age. But we know that he was a great Tana even before he went to the... And then we know about the 13 years that you were there in the cave. How...
And was his, did his son get the secrets as well? Was he,
yes, he was his chavruta. He learned with him. He was... I mean, later on, the Zohar explained that he opened a whole school, a whole Beit Midrash, and it was very hard to go to this exclusive people that was around him. It was, again, 13 people. It's all around 13, right? And the one who really wrote the Zohar from Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai was one of his disciples called Rabbi Abba. Rabbi Abba is the one that Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai appointed, you are going to write. And he wrote the major part of the Zohar, Rabbi Abba, which was his disciple. And the Zohar described how he taught the Kabbalah, but again, it doesn't mention how long he was teaching it and what was his age when he passed away. What we know that he passed away in Lag Ba'Omer, and I didn't have time to speak about the meaning of Lag Ba'Omer, but Lag Ba'Omer is a very big thing. You know what? If you're really curious about it, I could just invite you to a Hebrew lecture that's going to be tomorrow and the next week, Be'ezrat Hashem, by Mishpachat Ezer in Roslyn. So if it's not too far from you and you understand Hebrew, you are welcome to go there. And over there, I hope we'll have more time to even speak about the details about those things. All right, so this is it for today. It was different lecture than the one that you heard before over here.
Yeah.
But it's very unique, very exclusive, very, very special topic. I hope it wasn't too heavy. Okay. Thank you for your attention.